Well, hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Between Two Ferns. And I'm your host, Allie McMillan from the Federation of Calgary Communities. And my guests today are going to be Ostap and Kate, urban planners from the City of Calgary. Welcome.
Oh, thanks for having us.
Thank you.
I'm loving this Between the Two Ferns thing we have going on here. I totally am Zach Galifianakis, I'm sure. I've got the look. And we're just going to roll with this. So this is great. Jokes aside, really appreciate your time doing an informal question and answer, unedited, just sort of all of the questions that, you know, we've been hearing from community around some of the changes that the city is proposing, with obviously the goal being that we can inform as many people, as many Calgarians as possible before this comes to a public hearing where they have an opportunity to participate on October 4th, and just keep this in a broad format that people can watch at their leisure, right? So if they're taking the kids to sports or they're working during the day, they can watch this and hopefully get most of their questions answered. So we're just gonna go with an ask me anything type format, but I am gonna try to organize it between like kind of the three main things, the HGO, the new bylaw district, and then the RCG changes around row houses and then parking. So we'll try to organize it so people can kind of follow along. And of course, people can go on the calgary.ca/housing choice website and look at this stuff in a bit more detail too. So why don't you guys start with how we got here? How did we get to this point? Can you give us just a high level of like where this started and where we've gotten to today?
Sure, thanks. So yeah, that's a really interesting question. So I guess since 2019, council has been seeing a lot of custom-made zoning districts arrive in front of them for their decision. These are called direct control districts. And these have been kind of a riff off the standard kind of low density housing districts like the RCG district, but direct controls aren't very efficient. They take up a lot more council and staff time to do. And so in April, council gave us city staff the direction to come back with a standard district that would enable these types of housing forms. And we've done that work. We presented to IPC, Infrastructure and Planning Committee on September 9th. And that was passed forward to council on October 4th.
And so big part of what we're trying to do here is we've heard, especially from community members, that all these direct controls seem like it's rewriting the rules each time. And so how can we be clearer, more consistent, and so that there's better expectations for when these new housing forms are coming into a community, what standards those developments are being held to. So that's a big part of what we're trying to do here.
Okay, so council directed you to go away and do this work. Can you tell us kind of what research and engagement has been done to date to get us prepared for where we're at today?
So lucky in Calgary to have organizations like the Federation of Calgary Communities and all the community associations that are active and big participants in the planning process. So Ostap mentioned the high volume of direct control applications that we've been receiving. So our starting point for this work was to go back to those applications, go back to the comments that our colleagues that are file managers received through the application process, and go back to the public hearings where council was making decisions on those land use applications to hear what community and community associations were saying. So we're saying we heard things around the quality of amenity space, concerns around parking, concerns around inconsistencies with micro units and suites, concerns with how waste and recycling is being managed, et cetera, et cetera. And so from that starting point, we then looked at what actually was being approved by council and then did the work that is sort of the big job of planning is to how to balance different considerations. So we started thinking about how we might approach coming up with standardized rules, and then we got input from experts in waste and recycling, experts in the building code, and the folks who are actually building these projects, so we could make sure that the rules that we were putting together, even though we're striving really hard to reach a good balance, were practical and would actually get built. Because this big piece here is we didn't want to put together a new district or any regulations that from the get-go weren't actually feasible and would lend itself then to more direct control districts or relaxations, et cetera, et cetera. So I'd say that this work had a foundation of comments and feedback from community members. And then we worked to make sure with experts that that those rules would be feasible. All of this is up for council decision. So on October 4th, which we've already referenced a little bit, there will be a public hearing for this new district. And it's not going on the ground, it's being added to the land use bylaw and to the changes, the related changes in the RCG district and the multi-residential districts. And so what that means that it's going to public hearing is that anyone who's interested can show up and provide comments and or submit them through calgary.ca/planning.
Perfect. So our goal right now is to get everybody informed about exactly what those changes are. And then if they want to influence the decision, which is really the councillors will make the final decision on this, they need to participate in the process of going to council and writing in their letters. Correct?
Better than me, Allie. Thank you.
Okay. No, just summing up, making sure I'm understanding this correctly. Perfect. Okay. So let's get into the first proposal, which is a new land use district called HGO or HGO, but I'm going to go with HGO because my first question is, actually, why don't you tell us like what HGO is, a general, what is it and why is it happening?
I'm going to let OSEP do that, but I will say HGO stands for Housing Grade Oriented.
So HGO is essentially a average and an amalgamation, a putting together of all of those direct controls that were in front of council. Obviously, some are bigger, some are smaller, but what HGO is intended to do is it's intended to encompass the ones that are bigger. And these have been up to, 10 units and 10 suites. With a variety of different housing forms like row houses, townhouses. And the intent of HGO is to really provide a more flexible regulatory system to allow a lot of different unit configurations on the property. And that's kind of where we've arrived at solving direct controls with HGO, because it will address those larger direct controls that we're seeing.
Okay, so it's just kind of standardizing it so that it'll be more consistent and more certainty for people to understand what is coming. Exactly. Okay, perfect. So where does HGO go? Where does this apply in the city? Where can this be built?
A hot question.
So HGO is a unique district in that, one, it's new and it doesn't apply in either the low density residential districts or the multi-residential districts. It's on in a category of its own. And that's because the rewrite of the land use bylaw is coming in January 2023. And we're looking at this as an opportunity to trial run a lot of recent zoning best practices and then take that feedback, take the time that we have between now and then and evaluate some of those, see how it's working out. And that'll inform the broader land use bylaw rewrite.
And then in terms of the specific of where it will go, there's two categories with the new district. In one category, it is in areas with a local area plan, and specifically within areas that have been designated with the neighborhood connector or neighborhood flex urban form categories. And then for communities that don't have a local area plan, there are distances to priority growth areas. And when we say priority growth areas, we mean areas that have been identified by our municipal development plan as key areas for growth to help us get to our goal around more balanced growth between new communities and established communities. So those areas are activity centers and main streets, and then also proximity to LRT and BRT stations and to our primary transit network. And so there's specific distances in meters for each of those. And then the big, big piece is for the second category, it is for areas within the inner city. So again, that's also identified through our municipal development plan on the urban structure map. And it is, and I can show a map if we need it. Maybe I'll pull that up right now, actually.
And so this is mostly on like collector roads, busier streets. It's not in the mushy middle of these inner city neighborhoods.
We've done a lot of kind of mapping analysis work to ensure that it is generally concentrated around these kind of busier areas, around areas that are more walkable. You know, amenities are closer by. And that's really where HGO is intended to be focused.
So this is not going to be blanketed through the whole inner city everywhere. Okay, perfect.
So that map quickly, Allie. I know that.
Yeah, no, that's great because we had some questions about
faster than I see. But so the inner, this is our urban structure map from our NDP, and the areas in where the hand is, if you can see it in the sort of dark orange, is what's identified as our inner city.
And so within that inner city, within that orange, it will then be on these more main busier roads. And the 200 meters from a bus stop is as the crow flies, but that's a primary transit.
That's primary transit.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Perfect.
Which is also a map in our NDP if anyone's interested. So if you go to calgary.ca/NDP, you can look at those maps yourself, and there's a map that specifically shows our primary transit network.
Okay, so if you have a local area plan, it can go on those specified areas that are plugged in, and if you don't, it will use those distance measurements. Where can people see that if they want to see like the actual bylaw, what is proposed, and read through, you know, 200 meters from this, 400 from that? Where do they find that language?
Sure. So that language has been written into the purpose statement of the district. So that's the very first thing you see when you would open up the HGO section of the amending bylaw. And the intent there is for that information in that purpose statement to govern the recommendation that administration provides to council. So if it's out of those areas, generally administration will not recommend that council approve that application. And if it's within them, generally we would recommend that council would approve.
And if folks want to find the very specific wording of that purpose statement, if you go to calgary.ca/planningmatters, you get a direct link to our report, and it's attachment 2 in the report. And that's the full amending bylaw. And so it is for sure comes up in very legalese language because it has to go through all that process. But that's in there within the section that talks about the new district.
So when you guys use words like generally, or the bylaw says should or shall, can you explain to people why it seems kind of like there's some flexibility there and how that works?
Yeah, absolutely. So it's important to note that on land use matters, council is king. They make the they make the final decision. And as administration, we can't tell them what to do. And it is also anybody's legal right to apply for any rezoning that they wish. So should there be an application made to administration that administration doesn't support, however council supports, that would end up happening. And that's why I say generally, because although, you know, council may tend to follow the recommendation of administration, in no way are they bound by our recommendation.
Perfect. That's helps with that. So the next, the last thing before we leave this piece on HGO is, can it go in the suburbs, or why is just the inner city kind of like the focus of this?
Yeah, that's a really big piece. So there's a couple of reasons. One, because this is a new district, we're testing new things before we get to our land use bylaw renewal. So it's sort of limiting that, so we actually can get some monitoring and feedback of it. But the other piece is with local, like there's two other pieces. With a local area plan, as more communities go through a local area plan, for example, the forest lawn communities local area plan that has started. Those are outside the inner city, but they will then go through that process of identifying areas as neighborhood flex and neighborhood connectors. That's one piece. And the other piece is that's kind of why we're also including the recommendations to the multi-residential district. So even though it's not exactly the same rules as what's in the housing grade oriented district, it's still those existing districts still allow for versions of this form, and those districts, those multi-residential districts, can be used in new communities and are being used in new communities.
And one thing to note there is, since this new district is intended to encompass those larger direct controls, we looked at where those larger direct controls were being built. So 98% of those larger direct controls were being built in the inner city, with the vast majority of those being on neighborhood connector or neighborhood flex type streets. So we've really tried to mirror all of the kind of market considerations of those DCs in the new district.
That's a great point, Austin.
Okay, I'm going to switch over to, since HGO can have stacked units, there's a lot of question around the difference between, or I guess the word micro suites comes up. And it's like, what is a suite? What is a secondary suite? What is a unit? Could you clarify those terms?
So in the land use bylaw, we do not have a use that's called micro. It's come up through the applications for some of these recent direct controls, but it's not a use in our land use bylaw. And in the new district, the HGO district, we do not include micro suites as a thing. We include suites and we include dwelling units, regardless of their size. Secondary suites have their own rules around them, their own building code implications, but we have, if you're a dwelling unit, you're a dwelling unit regardless of the size. And both suites and dwelling units, so whether unit or a suite, you require the same, you have the same parking rate applying to you. So the same parking rate applies.
I could provide a bit of clarity on the micro suites. So our previous, our current parking rules only reduced the parking rate for suites if they were under a certain size. And that is kind of where the term micro suite came about, because it was designating that these units were below the size required so that they didn't have to have any parking.
So that gets a bit to the unclarity, actually, and why it was important for us to address that and have standard rules. There's not sort of these ways that folks were getting around things.
Yeah.
Perfect. That's helpful. And a secondary suite is secondary to the primary residence, so it's all part of that, whereas a unit is just a unit. And that's, I guess, a good segue into my next question is, how can these, what's the ownership structure on these types of things? And, you know, how would the public space be maintained? If can these be owned separately, or is it condos, or what, how does it work?
If you have a new development that's full of units of different sizes, those units could be sold. Usually that building will be condoized or go through the Condominium Act. And so that each unit is attached to a different title. And then there might be shared amended or shared property or common property that everyone's responsible for the maintenance, etc. And then they might also have some private amenity space that's tied to their unit. If there are secondary suites, a secondary suite is linked to that main unit, so it's under the same ownership. And then what we've seen for some row house developments to date is it might also sometimes follow a fee simple route, which means that there's a party wall, but otherwise people are buying like a typical parcel, and it's not not necessarily a condo. So we expect there could in some developments, you might even have a mix of both of those approaches. But big picture answer is that they are owned, and where there's shared property or shared amenity space, it is usually tied to common property.
In terms of the maintenance of that space, generally they pay monthly condo fees, and they contract out the landscaping, snow removal, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, it's decided by the folks that are all part of that condo.
Okay. And can HGO have secondary suites?
Yes.
Okay. But they would be attached, then they could also have another unit stacked as well.
No, that would not be allowed, because that would be three units above each other.
So in the in the HGO district where you'd have a suite, it can't have stacked units above it. So you'd have, if it's a two-story front building, for example, in a courtyard development, and those, that front building has two-story units with suites below, and then in the rear building, you might have two units, so the same height, but two units. But it, with the building code regulations, et cetera, you can't mix stacked units with a secondary suite.
Perfect. Thank you. That's clear. I got that. That's helpful. Just can you briefly touch on Airbnbs? People are concerned these are all going to become Airbnbs.
Any dwelling unit in the city of Calgary that wants to be an Airbnb has to apply for a business license. And there was a whole project that worked on Airbnbs a couple of years ago. And the team did a great job, and that was their recommendation, and that's what's been implemented.
Perfect. Are these units going to be affordable? People are concerned that they're not, this is not affordable housing. Can you speak to affordability generally, I guess?
These units are not affordable housing as defined by the city. There's a whole definition around that that is tied to the household income, et cetera, et cetera. What this work is all about is expanding housing choice in Calgary. So providing more options and more supply of, because these forms of housing, especially in our inner city communities, are seeing a real peak in demand. But we also have quite a bit of, like, why we're doing this work is that there's a lot of regulatory barriers that make it hard to meet that demand and leads to a limited supply. And so OSAP's got a great line, and I'll let them share it, but, or maybe I'll try to say it, which is that housing supply alone
is not sufficient
for reaching housing affordability, but it's a big part of expanding the options that are available in our housing market.
It when you're tearing down an old house, it's really about what are you going to replace it with? And in the inner city right now, it's fairly easy to replace it with a large single detached home or two semi-detached homes. And based on kind of current price points, those are going, you know, approximately $800,000, $1 million. When you replace it with something like this, you're dropping that price down significantly. So it's really just about, if the house has to go, what is allowed to replace it?
And you're getting more housing units as well, exactly, to contribute to the overall. Okay. Great. I'm just going to touch on, these are going to have courtyard spaces. So how do we make sure they're like big enough to deal with trees, landscaping? Like, is anyone going to be able to use these spaces? What are these courtyards going to look like?
That was a huge part of this work, because that was a big part of the comments that that we heard from Calgarians in all the direct control applications to date. So the courtyard width for both the changes in RCG and for the new district is 6.5 meters. Thank you, Asta. So that's one piece. The other piece is that we've seen with these developments also lots of innovation around amenity space and open space for these developments, where there's more sharing of amenity space along with some like private balconies, etc. And so the approach we've taken is, how can we support the best quality instead of having people designing to numeric minimums? So we've included some important minimums in the district, for example, around a minimum tree count and shrub count per 100 square meters, and also a minimum amount of 30% for soft landscaping. But outside of that, while we require amenity space, we're providing more flexibility of how that's achieved. And to help support both applicants and our colleagues that will be reviewing these applications, and all the community association volunteers that review applications that come in, we also created the landscape design guide for small residential sites to explain what are our expectations, and showing pictures of examples in Calgary that have achieved great quality. So we're hopeful that will help. And this is one of the big pieces that we'll be monitoring to see, has this approach been successful, and what can we build from when we get to the land use bylaw review?
Okay. Can HGO districts be amalgamated? Lots amalgamated to make a couple HGO parcels put together.
Yeah, for sure. So you can technically do that with any district. There becomes kind of a point at which market realities set in. So for example, you know, through these direct controls, we've been seeing one, two, the rare three parcel assembly being put together. But once you go really beyond that, what it's just more financially kind of lucrative to develop a multi-residential building, like an apartment building, because you get more units and there's kind of, you know, a lot. It's a more tried and true process, essentially. So while it is possible, it's probably impractical to the point of being not realistic.
And we also have to remember that the maximum height of this district is 12 meters, which is three stories. And so there's only, this is fitting a real market niche for the type of product. And once you're getting into those market realities that Ostap talked about, you're generally needing higher buildings to accommodate.
Yeah. And that's also because HGO is technically competing for the same land that the multi-residential districts are competing on along those nodes and corridors in the inner city. So, you know, that's where the point, the four parcel, five parcel land assemblies for HGO, I don't think that's something that we'll be seeing.
We'll watch and we'll see. And if it happens, then it's something we'll have to address.
So the last thing before we move to row housing and RCG is just I really want to make sure I understand like how this will end up on the ground from. So right now it's just like another use in the toolbox. And if somebody wants to actually put this somewhere, could you clarify how that works and when it's permitted? And
yeah, absolutely. So I guess a minor correction. Right now, it's not a tool in the toolbox, but potentially on October 4th, should council choose to approve it, the bylaw is effective January 2nd. So that's when we would start, you know, processing applications under this use. But
the district.
But how this generally works is a applicant would apply, administration would evaluate that application, administration being city staff. It would go to Calgary Planning Commission. They would pass it on to council. Should council approve it through a public hearing, then that land use would be on a piece of land. Should the landowner want to build something, they would have to go through the development permit approval process, in which case there's another opportunity for public input and comment. And then finally, should that development permit be approved, it would go on to the building permit stage.
Okay, perfect. So how did we get into touching the RCG stuff? Or what did you guys find when you were doing this work that made you then need to adjust some things in RCG? And what are you adjusting?
That's the guy for that.
Yeah.
He did a lot of his work.
Yeah, absolutely. So that's really interesting because RCG has been kind of recognized to not be a viable redevelopment district on mid-block parcels for a number of years. And this problem has actually been subject to two separate motions from council directing an administration to fix it, essentially. And the plan was originally to just roll that into the new land use bylaw renewal. When we received this motion from Councillor Sharp and Chabot in April, it directed us to fix the problem of direct control applications. And what we found through our analysis was that approximately 60% of direct control applications were larger. So they were for things like the new district would cover, but 40% of them were for smaller developments. And specifically, they were trying to tweak RCG to have it be viable mid-block. So these direct controls were trying to, on their own, kind of fix a problem that the city had already identified with the RCG district. And essentially, our work here has been to do what we can to make RCG a viable redevelopment option in the middle of the block, outside of just corner parcels.
Okay, so where will this impact in the city, the RCG changes?
A quick answer, that's if you go to calgary.ca/housing-choice, there's a map on there that shows all existing RCG parcels in this city. So that change in terms of what impacts on the ground is those are the parcels that this will affect.
That are already zoned. Those are the ones that are already zoned RCG.
Today, exactly. And Asaf can pull that map up if it's helpful. I feel like it's just,
yeah, okay, well, I don't know, that might be tough.
Yeah, calgary.ca/housing-choice. This is probably the quickest way to get it. But an important caveat there, just because something is enabled doesn't mean someone's going to develop it. So the change to the land use district changes the rules, or and in this case is adding a new use. But someone still has to be interested to develop. Someone has to go through the process to develop, et cetera, et cetera. So that, and those existing RCG parcels are really concentrated in a couple areas. They're concentrated around the 17th Ave Southeast and Southwest Main Streets. And so that was a redesignation through our Main Streets program. So that's Forest Lawn and Killarney, essentially for communities. And then similarly around Bowness and Montgomery, also through that Main Streets redesignation process. And then there's another cluster in Capitol Hill and Banff Trail, where the city, working with the community association, went through a redesignation process a couple of years ago. Outside of that, there's been individual applications. And again, as Asaf mentioned around where we've been seeing the DC applications for the larger sort of HGOs type developments, those are concentrated in the inner city. So that map shows where all of those are.
Okay, so this will be a discretionary use. Can you explain what that means and how people that are concerned about like their neighboring property, overlook, privacy, height, shadow, how that would, how they could participate in making sure that that's not an issue for them?
Short answer is the same as it is today. Long answer, go ahead.
Yeah, sure. So a discretionary use is a use that the development authority, meaning city staff, can apply discretion on. This is in contrast to a permitted use, which is also known as a by right use. So if you have that zoning and it's a permitted use and you meet all the rules, the city has to provide you with a permit. A discretionary use can be either can be refused. We can attach conditions to it, you know, in response to concerns, and it can also be appealed to the Subdivision and Development Appeals Board.
Okay, so these will be discretionary, and if they don't exist right now, you'd have to get a land use to change the zoning to RCG.
Exactly.
And go through the land use public hearing, and then also go through a discretionary development permit.
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. Thanks for clarifying that. So is the building footprint of these new RCGs or the height, is that changing from what it is now?
No. The maximum height of RCG is 11 meters and it's staying the same. Because we've now allowed, or we are proposing to allow a rear building, we acknowledge that that could have potentially stronger negative land use impacts. So we've limited the height of the rear building down to 8.6 meters. Which is just slightly more than what's allowed in a backyard suite.
Okay, and same lot coverage.
Parcel coverage is the same for both the HGO district and RCG district. Lot coverage is not changing.
Okay, and these can have suites. RCG could have suites in them.
Yeah,
secondary suites.
Yeah. They can have
but
suites,
not stacked units.
Unless the applicant chooses to apply for RCGEX, which is kind of a variation of that district, then they will not be allowed. RCGEX does not allow suites.
Okay. Could you just touch briefly on setbacks? Are setbacks changing in any way with these districts?
Yeah.
I can start.
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
There are changes to the setbacks. And so the change with RCG is having a minimum front yard setback of 3.0 meters, which is a shift from how it is today, which includes the contextual setbacks. And there's a lot of looking, or not a lot of looking, that's the technical term, a lot of analysis, as Asaf has mentioned before, about the applications that we've been seeing as to where that came from. So I'll let him speak to that.
Yeah, sure. So based on the kind of smaller direct controls that we've been seeing, they've been writing 3 meters into their front setback rule. But when it comes time to do the actual development permit, what we generally see is a little bit larger of a setback. The front setbacks are generally important because this is available land on the site. So and it has a lot of effects on the rest of the site design. So for example, where you have one building, a courtyard, and another building, if you were to push that setback, far back, it would actually make that courtyard smaller and potentially impact the quality of that space. So it's all really a balancing act. And we've tried to, make decisions that get housing built and, put housing on the ground for Calgarians while acknowledging, so some of the preferences around a larger setback.
I think this is such a good example, Ali, of when we talk about how there's trade-offs, especially for this scale of development where the finances are tight, the parcels aren't huge, and there's smaller developments, that to get one thing impacts something else, and this little bit of give and take to try to overall get a good development, and the setbacks are one of the key pieces of that. And I know, especially for Calgarians and citizens of established communities that are really familiar with things with contextual development and the history of that in Calgary, that this will feel like a really big shift. But my take-home message there is we've worked really hard to try to get to a good balance so we get the best possible outcome. And similar to everything else, we'll be watching this to see if it's successful or not, so we can learn and build from that for the land use bylaw rewrite.
Another one that I forgot that you just triggered me that people are really going to care about is waste and recycling.
Oh, yeah.
Can you just give an overview of what's happening with HGO and RCG around that?
Yeah, so this is probably why you remind you of it, because it's a trade-off on the site. So in listening back to a lot of those public hearings, waste and recycling was one of the major identified concerns at kind of this level of density. So the first thing that we did is we are now going to require applicants to show a specific site for those waste and recycling storage uses.
A corral or like an area, yeah, to store them? That's, yeah, what we're talking about? Okay.
Exactly. And those uses will have to be located in a place that's user-friendly, that goes along with how people actually use their bins. And it'll have to be screened from adjacent parcels. What we frequently heard was that we require so much parking that it makes these places, that it makes waste and recycling storage difficult to accommodate in a way that's not intrusive. And the reduction in the parking stall requirement by one stall grants an additional, approximately 350 square feet that allows the site to kind of be a bit more flexible and architects and builders can now use their kind of best practices in placing these areas where they need to go. The other thing that we've done is with this landscaping guide for small residential sites, it informs applicants that, not every unit and suite requires 3 bins. You are allowed to share bins. So that will result in a direct reduction in the amount of bins. And we're also encouraging new technologies for waste storage, such as semi-underground storage, which industry has also indicated that they're very interested in.
Are those mollocks? Is that what that is?
Yes.
Things that a private pickup comes and sucks them out of the ground?
Absolutely.
Okay.
I learned something new today. I did not know that they were called semi-underground, but it makes perfect sense. I guess mollocks is like,
It's like the Kleenex. Yeah, I was gonna say.
Yeah, but you can put more stuff and they take up less room and you can put more waste into those. Yeah.
And through a lot of our site tours, what we also recognize is that untidy bins is not an issue that is unique to row houses, townhouses, or any of these other kind of missing middle housing forms. So I think over the long term and we'll have to look, we'll have to work with our partners in waste and recycling to improve the general amount of enforcement that we do at the city.
Like Austin's looking directly at me and like, Kate, do you keep your bins outside or are they in your garage? Hide behind the fern.
Hide behind the fern. Oh my gosh. Okay. A big one that comes up around all of these before we move to parking, because I know everyone's going to want to ask about parking, is just heritage, and that the heritage guidelines work is not yet really finished. So how will heritage be affected by these changes?
Yeah, that's a great question, Allie. And where we've heard the question really specifically is coming out of the North Hill communities, because they're currently going through that process. And the concern around where some of the heritage sites are on existing multi-residential parcels or areas that are currently identified with the neighborhood flex or neighborhood connector urban form categories. So a big part of this work is for us, and why we've recommended to delay implementation to January 2nd, is so that we can do training with our colleagues who are getting these applications, and also providing information for the public, who for applicants and for community associations. So through that training is the piece that if this if there's an application for HGO within an area that's identified by those heritage guidelines, that we should be recommending refusal. And the reason why is because within the housing grade oriented district, dwelling unit is a permitted use, and the whole sort of key piece of that heritage work is around discretionary uses. So in those cases, what we would be recommending, what our colleagues would be working with applicants on, is to instead use one of our existing multi-residential districts, because in those cases, multi-residential development is a discretionary use, and so they're able to use and to utilize those guidelines and that discretionary process.
So what about an area where there's no local area plan, I guess, and we have heritage homes, just like we do today? How is that approached?
If there is a designated heritage resource that's been designated by the city through all of our application review, because all that's been mapped and flagged, and so if that comes up, it requires a circulation to our colleagues in heritage planning and that process through the application review to talk about that heritage asset, talk about the incentives for designation, et cetera, et cetera. So there's that. In cases where something's a heritage asset, like a character home, but is not designated, then there can be the same conversation, but it's up to the landowner what they would like to do. And that's where we can talk about how best to deal with the adjacent parcels, if there might be a couple heritage assets stored in one another.
Okay, so parking, everyone's
the same as today. Oh, sorry, I interrupted.
Yeah, so nothing is really, it kind of is the same, whether it's a HGO, a row house, a single house, it's just
RC1, RC2, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, it's all the same.
Everyone's favorite topic, parking. We got to go there. Can you explain what you're proposing and why you're making the change?
Sure, absolutely. So before I go into what we're proposing, I think it's useful to evaluate kind of what we've been seeing with these direct controls that our work is designed to address. So with these direct controls, the requirement for parking was effectively one parking stall per one unit, and a secondary suite was not required to have a parking stall if it was smaller and located close to transit. What ended up happening was builders would be intentionally reducing the size of that secondary suite to get that parking reduction. And council, so the effective parking rate of all of these developments was 0.5 stalls per unit and suite combined. And the vast majority of them have been approved by council. So that's kind of the context of where we're at. And in evaluating, you know, the demands on the site that we've been talking about this whole time, all of these trade-offs for waste and recycling space, for amenity space, even tree preservation, the courtyard width, all of these things, it just became very clear that of all these things, the parking stall takes up a large amount of area and, you know, really limits the flexibility of site design. So our proposal is to reduce our minimum parking requirement by one. So where before we would have four units and four suites have four parking stalls, now it would be four units and four suites would only be required to have three parking stalls. And that's how we're proposing to address the kind of demands on the site and improve waste and recycling, improve potentially tree preservation, improve the amenity space in the area, as well as kind of meet more recent planning but best practices when it comes to minimum parking standards.
I think that last part's so important, Ostap, is that like this is all happening within a broader context with cities across cities and towns, like communities across Canada. We know that our friendly neighbors to the north in Edmonton a couple of years ago have introduced zero parking minimum citywide for all uses. They've been followed by some of the recent work happening in Toronto. Okotoks, our next door neighbor, has zero parking minimums. High River, shout out to High River, they kind of led the parade here in Alberta with doing that over 5 years ago. And so this is across city building professions, there's been a bit of a reevaluation of how do we end up with the numbers we have and what are we really trying to get to? So this is all within that context. And we've already seen some work in Calgary addressing that. We had
and just because you have a parking minimum doesn't mean people have to do that rate. It's just providing the flexibility for them to see what works on their site. Is that the point? Builders will
be perfectly free to build four parking stalls on these after these changes.
I think that's such an important point, Allie, because this is a minimum, not a maximum. And by including the minimum, that's a bit more open, it allows that space for the market to respond.
I have to ask about on-street parking then, because people are concerned that these reduced parking rates are going to cause spillover onto the, you know, someone will be parking in front of their house or, so could you explain how that gets managed?
Yeah, absolutely. So this is another area where academic research and kind of studies from various municipalities is really important. So research shows that people pick where they live based on their transportation preferences. A resident or a Calgarian who owns, you know, two large vehicles is not likely to purchase a home where there's no parking available. Homes with fewer parking spaces are a valuable housing option for residents that own fewer or no cars, for residents that drive less or that want to take more transit or walk and bike to their everyday destinations. And these homes are actually currently undersupplied in the city because we've been attaching minimum parking requirements to our residential developments since 1957.
To be exact.
In our second ever land use bylaw, And I guess finally, research actually also indicates that storage in a garage is a more popular use of garage space than vehicle parking. So minimum parking requirements don't prevent residents from parking on a public street. In fact, minimum parking requirements bring more cars to an area and contribute more to road and curb congestion.
And this is another big context thing, which is both helpful and not sometimes, I know, for these conversations, because it's about climate change as well, right? So Calgary has declared the climate emergency. Council recently adopted our climate plan. And it's this question of how are we actually in Calgary going to not just make those commitments, but put it into action. And this is one of the ways to do it that's really tied to lifestyle choices and to individual choices. So it doesn't mean if you have a house today, whether it's a single detached or you live in an apartment that we're saying you can't have parking. What we're looking at is people who are purchasing new homes and new developments who might be seeking different options than the options that are available today.
So it's going to be 0.375 across all of these districts. So it's all the same in the mix.
And that's kind of another reason, because there's the parking changes to RCG and HCO, and then there's the broader kind of multi-residential parking conversation. And the reason we're proposing to standardize parking rates across all of these multi-residential districts and RCG and HCO is because they're a major barrier to redevelopment citywide. So it's a citywide issue. Specifically, the changes to the multi-residential districts, that'll allow higher intensity redevelopment to be more economically viable on higher traffic roads and those priority growth areas that we talked about, the main streets, the LRT stations, things like that. And applying, if we were to have a differentiated approach, for example, if we were to apply these lower minimums only within the inner city, that would have fairly profound and inequitable effects. And what I kind of mean by that is that parking requirements are uniquely harmful to lower cost apartments specifically. And these apartments tend to be located further from downtown. So higher end apartments can attach the significant costs of building underground parking to those units. Whereas if you force lower cost apartments to do that, two things happen. Either the development doesn't get built, or the development turns into a higher cost apartment building. Either way, this reduces the new supply of more modest apartments or homes in the city. And this obviously has fairly drastic housing affordability and equity implications. So that's fundamentally why we are recommending the standardized citywide approach to reducing minimum parking
requirements. And also to limit, like, a key part of this, of the motion arising that we got direction from in April, is to minimize the number of DCs. So we'd hate to put all this work in and then just incentivize everybody, not everybody, that's like incentivize people with existing multi-residential parcels to run it redesignate to this district, but then to reach the densities that they currently have available to them to do like another mix and match with rules. And so a big part of that is also that consistency and that clarity.
We have covered a lot of territory. I'm like, anyone who's still with us out there, like, thank you. Thank you for listening. So I do want to give folks more information about, you know, when, where, how we can hear from them and that kind of thing, but I'm going to do it in a rapid fire format. So you guys have to be 10 seconds or less, like yes or no, quick on these last questions. I'm just going to fire them out and then, we'll wrap up after that. So, okay. Who is the decision maker on these changes?
So, I feel like Ashap and I are in a rut.
Yeah, I feel like there should be like a button here. Like, yeah.
Okay. How can the public comment on the proposed changes?
That's all through the public hearing process. So go to calgary.ca/planningmatters and there's great information. That play just got updated recently. Great information on how to submit comments, whether you want to send them written or to show up to the public hearing in person.
And also, if this does get approved, every application in the future, there will be a public hearing. You can comment.
For HGO.
You guys are... Hey, beep,
beep. I'm sorry.
How are you informing Calgarians about these changes? How can they learn about this beside this video?
Calgary.ca/housing choice. Lots of information on the website. Or also, we're going to be posting information on Twitter, directing people to the website. We've got this video that the FCC so kindly is going to be sharing through their channels as well. Also, next week, we're hoping to have an Ask Me Anything session on Reddit for anyone who's on Reddit and likes that forum. Keep your eyes peeled to the YYC Plan Twitter account where we'll be announcing that. And then after this video is posted, which we're aiming to have that by the end of this week, we expect that there probably, even though this is taking forever, that we haven't answered all questions. So you can send questions through our website on that calgary.ca/housing choice or to our friends at the Federation of Calgary Communities. And we will do a second video if we haven't lost everyone's attention. Yeah.
And also we sent out approximately 10,000 letters to every RCG parcel in the city and every neighboring parcel to an RCG parcel. So there's more information in there.
Perfect. So if they have a question that wasn't asked today, they can email it to myself, Allie@calgarycommunities.com, or on the city website, and we'll try to get that for round two of our video. Three more quick ones. Can you still build single detached housing in your neighborhood, in the inner city?
Yes.
What is missing middle?
So missing middle, yeah, this is not a 10-second question.
10 seconds.
All right, so missing middle, big term being used across North America. In Calgary, we see it as typically showing up as buildings that are that allow two or more units up to three stories. That could be a semi-detached to a small apartment building. Yep.
Bigger than a small house, smaller than a mid-rise apartment.
And they're not really missing in Calgary, but we make it really hard to build them and there's so much demand for them. And so that's what this work is trying to help.
That was my next question. Okay. The middle isn't missing. The middle isn't missing. Is the middle missing?
The middle isn't missing, but it's much harder to build than other forms of housing. So we're trying to make it easier.
All right. Well, that was fun. That was fun, you guys. Thank you so much for your time. You had amazing stamina. I just had to ask questions and you had to do all the talking. So super
thank you so
appreciate
much.
The forum, and hopefully we'll hear from Calgarians if there's other things they want to know. And thanks for trying to get the information out to people.
Our pleasure. It's been wonderful working with you.
Thanks so much, Ali.
Thank you.
Bye.